they can actually shrink all the way down to a rock hard rhizome, and they'll come back, they'll spring back to life.
What about the Japanese ones?
Japanese are a water-loving iris.
Oh, they are?
Okay. Yes, yeah. So you have to think of anything from Asia is basically a water-loving iris. Anything that's native to the Asia. Right now is the monsoon season. They're getting flash floods and everything in China. So from June on, see, they actually start, the Japanese iris is a cultural treasure for the Japanese people. When that iris bloomed, that signified to them that it was time to plant rice. So, okay, a bearded iris. This is what they look like when they're overgrown and ratty. Does anybody notice that in their garden?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I'm new. I don't have it yet.
This crown is 3 years old from a single fan. Thank you. This type is a native to our East Coast. It's a cristata.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so the first thing you do is you find out and you learn that there's hardly any roots to them, because as an iris grows, you see all the leaves are gone, and these are the oldest leaves. I'll show you. These are the oldest leaves. Your newest leaf is always in the center. As the rhizome grows, and the same thing with the roots. Notice there's no roots back here. All the roots are here. All of your new roots, when I get into a bigger thing, you'll really see all of the new roots will always grow from your front. So all this back stuff is all, like I said before, it's all dead, it's gone, get rid of it. And the easiest, and so you'll find on these types of viruses, especially bearded, all this stuff is dead stuff back here. All of your new roots are going to be up in front. So the first thing, so you just slide. That's another reason with a square cut shovel. You can just slide it right underneath the rhizome, the rhizomes, and take the bed up just like this, and you don't have to worry about it. So the first thing that you do is get the dirt off.
What color is it?
Oh, I can't remember which. I think this was a orangey gold one. So now we can start seeing. Get this different stuff out of here. Now you can see the mat. So here was, look how big that rhizome is compared to these. I'm overdue by a full year of lifting and dividing this iris. I have already taken parts of this in my iris field. This one was to be thrown away. But this is how big the rhizome should be. And look how big they are this year. And see, so here was mom, here's grandma, here's great-grandma. So you can see, two. So we've had this year, one, two, three, four. This mat is only 4 years old. And they're already going downhill. That's why we say every 2 to 3 years. A lot of the growers, actually with the bearded irises, they do these. They lift and divide them every single year so that their customers get these nice, big, huge rhizomes that will bloom for them. So, this all just breaks apart, just like this. Some are easier than others. Like I said, be brutal, get in here. Here we can see where this year, mom, see here's the bloom stem. She bloomed, and then these are the daughters. See, here's the...
That's cool.
You can really see it with the bearded irises. when we get into those, it's exactly the same.
Oh.
Exactly the same. I mean, a little light should start going off here. These are really easy to deal with. It's just how do I get in there and how do I deal with it?
Do you plant the daughters then, basically?
Yes. Now this one, because it is like so weak, you could plant the daughters individually. Now these will not bloom next year. I can tell because they should have been this big. So you can either do it. What I would do with this clump is I would have probably picked out from the outside of the ring. You'll notice on the outside is where your largest fans are. That's because they had new soil to anchor their roots into, and they got away from Grandma. She ate all the food. the pantry's empty. And you can see that this is when they're starting to actually climb over each other. So, like I said, don't be afraid to get in there and take out all this stuff. Now you can really, okay, there we have.
So is it too late to divide the ones that are in the ground this year?
No, this is prime time right now. We always say around here, October 15th that's kind of your cutoff date. So here again is great-grandma, grandma, mom, daughter. And if you wanted to, what you'd do is just get rid of grandma.
Oh, no.
Great-grandma. Oh. Now, I did snap those off. Now, this is a trick with this. You want to make sure that you actually have a clean cut and not a rough cut. And the other thing would be, so you have a nice clean cut, take out the bloom stem, take off the old foliage, cut this foliage back. This is why when you get irises, they're cut back like that. It's not because we're tidying them up, it's because we're transplanting them. So don't cut back the foliage at this time of the year. Yeah, sorry, I'll wait.
So don't cut the foliage this time of year?
Yeah, unless it's really ratty looking.
Oh.
So don't cut the foliage. People say, well, when do I cut the foliage back in the summertime? If the plant is growing well, you should not have, it should be growing, it should be green. If they start looking like this, they are overgrown and they need to be transplanted. But a good healthy plant should be green here in the Pacific Northwest all summer long.
So
a good bearded iris.
You only cut them like that when you're transplanting.
When you're transplanting, right. Because this plant is still feeding itself for next year's bloom. So what I would do with this, again, is you clean up the plant. And what you can do, you have to remember, all of your new roots are always going to come from the front. All of this stuff, basically, this is actually dead. You can tell.
Yeah.
This is dead roots. So just go in there and cut out your dead roots. And then just plant this. And on bearded irises, you want to plant them so that this white part is laying down in the ground.
You always keep them together. You don't snap off the babies.
Well, when they're young, when they're small like this, I would almost plant them back like this. But you can, yes, you can go ahead and cut off the daughters.
It won't hurt them.
It won't hurt them.
So when you,
but they won't bloom.
But they will. These are too small to bloom.
Right.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So the soil right up to the bottom of the white part, like the root collar.
Yes. where people get wrong with irises, especially with bearded irises. Let me get a fresh one here.
Would it bloom if the mom and the babies were still together?
No. The rhizome will only bloom once if it is in good growing condition. And once it's in good growing condition, you'll see, sometimes you'll see a rhizome that if it's in bad growing condition, the rhizome will just keep on growing and growing and growing and growing mm-hmm. without blooming and without breaking apart into daughters.
Over all the rest of them, yeah.
Right. They get longer and longer and longer, trying to get to good soil, good sun. And then once it blooms, then the daughters break out from around the bloom. Yeah.
If you keep dividing and transplanting, what's to prevent this from taking over your whole yard?
It's called gardening. Like I said, zucchini of the flower world. Okay, you notice that this plant, the leaves are not perpendicular to the soil. People make the big mistake of planting going like this. My root zone, you're not going to stand up, are you? My root zone is here. That is now above soil. You need to put it down so the root zone is in the soil, like this. And this is barely, you should be able to see this, but just barely covered, if anything. But that's your soil line right there. So you don't want to plant it like this. You see my so it goes like this. These are very, very forgiving. Bearded irises, very forgiving. That's why we grow a lot of them here. They're tough plants. However, the other type of iris that I'd like to get into, I think, are some of the most handsome plants in and out of bloom. And they are very tough. And that is the Siberian irises. I don't know who grows Siberians here, but the same thing goes on with that clump. Most people grow their Siberians until they are well too old and very, very difficult. You might as well hire the 18-year-old kid down the road and bring in a stick of dynamite, because it's going to be very, very tough. This was one rhizome. This is one half of a clump. I cut it in half. This was one rhizome 4 years ago.
Wow.
This is a Siberian. So they are very handsome plants, in and out of bloom. They look like a nice foliage grass plant. I think they're just gorgeous. Everything that I just showed you here is also happening in this root ball. We just can't see it because it's underground. So here, I cut it right in half. Here actually is the starting point of this whole clump. Four generations, so great-great-great-grandma. So the same thing is happening here. So I'm going to handle it just like I do those.
Yep.
So let's try to break it up a little bit more. So this, by the way, is what your soil should look like, where it just crumbles.
Compost.
Yep, lots of compost. Okay, now again, like I said, remember everything in back, the irises, you're going to find your strongest growth is going to be on the outside ring. Here's the outside ring that you're looking at. You're looking at the outside ring. Inside, it's actually, there's hardly any foliage. It's all bloom stems. Remember what I said, the rhizome will only bloom once. So all this stuff in the center is dead. It's gone. So it's really easy with Siberians to cut them in half like this when they're a couple, only a few years old. when they get to 6 and 7 years old, you'll have a very difficult time cutting through this. That's why I say you have to have a very, very sharp shovel and a good pair of legs to jump on it. So the easiest way on these guys is actually to grab a clump. And I'm going to get all of this foliage out of my way, just like I did with the, so we start looking at what the plant looks like in here. These are all the really strong daughters on a Siberian. You can see the new roots. The new roots are the green, are the white ones. And they're always on the nose. It's exactly the same. And look at this. Now this was the foliage for this year. So that's next year's bloom. Look at the bottom. There's the daughter for next year's plant.
Awful close.
That's why these things like to be lifted and divided every so many years, because they get way too on top of each other. So the rhizomes, each individually rhizome, usually it's, once you break it out like that, it's really easy to go in from the backside and just peel it away just like an onion. Or just grab the rhizome and just pull it off.
So it's moist instead of the Mediterranean.
Yes, these like to be kept moist.
Throughout the year.
Yep. So on this, that little handful, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 plants. And let me clean two of these up so that you can inspect it a little closer. I'll take out all of the old foliage and clean up the plant. Remember all the old roots, because the new roots are on the outside. So you back cut off the rhizome.
Yeah.
You think that's a lot of plants now, huh?
Oh, no.
Like I said, your neighbors will—they'll be starting to lock the doors and throw. You know, no way.
When you transplant these, how close together would you put them?
This is the trick to Siberians and to these guys. If you want that massive clump look in 1 year time or 2 years time, that looks fantastic, and you only have to lift and divide this thing every 2 years and make a garden look really, really good, plant them like hair plugs. Boom, 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 boom. So you have a garden full of them, and you don't have to work with this clump, because when a plant is only 2 years old or less than 3 years old, they just fall apart because they're not grown into each other yet. Little trick with the gardening,
I have to do this very thing.
So, and people go, well, that's a lot of work. We're gardeners.
Yeah, hell.
That's what we do.
Are these ones with the little purplish flowers, the real little ones?
They can be purple. We also have yellows now. We have browns. We have reds.
I think I have one.
Someone
gave it.
Someone
gave it to me too.
This is the iris that most people would have in their garden.
Yeah, because it kind of.
Besides a bearded iris.
Okay. And what about growing them in pots versus in the garden?
Oh, pot
doesn't
containers,
matter.
Fine. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. So I'll go ahead and pass this around. So.
Just to clarify, that big clump you have.
Yes.
Was this one of those parts?
Yes.
So if you do the little hair plug thing, it does mean you have to have a lot of maintenance in a couple of years.
Correct.
Okay.
That's so neat.
We appreciate you holding that for 4 years for us.
So how many irises do you have at your house?
I have about 3 acres.
Of irises?
Of just irises.
Oh my goodness. How do you keep them all happy?
I lift and divide 1/3 every year. And then I have, and then 80 to 90% of the fields, I try to keep fallow, because these are the very, very hungry plants. So I do cover crops, and I rotate.
Are you going to run out of space?
If I run out of space, I'm overloaded, and I need to cut back, because I do it all by myself. I have 10 acres of gardens, and I do it all myself.
All by yourself?
All by myself.
Oh,
yes?
If I'm out of room and I want to start putting them like on my deck in pots,
yes.
Do I want wood or plastic, and what size?
Great, good question. First of all, you want to double pot. Yeah!
Oh, okay.
Plants do not like to have their roots cooking in the sun. Okay, so you think about this. Almost around here, you'll see that all the ceramics, now they're doing this. These are what I call double pot.
Yeah.
That keeps the sun off the container and keeps the roots cool. It also, in the wintertime, you don't have to worry about, I have not lost one ceramic pot where I live in the Columbia River Gorge, 17 degrees for weeks on end, and frozen, I have not lost one ceramic pot due to breakout. What breaks the ceramic pot is when they're filled with soil, and the soil expands, and it bumps out on the wall. That's what breaks a ceramic pot.
So you put them in plastic and then the ceramic.
Yes.
Yep.
Good trick.
I just have a suggestion. It's kind of related.
Yeah.
You have these classes at your farm, and then have us do like portions of your farm, because I've already learned enough that I would feel comfortable.
I just have to have everybody with a shovel, or I'll just,
yeah.
I, right.
I'm already finding huge value in just the few minutes that I've spent.
Yeah.
Incredible.
So with these, those didn't really show it as much. Actually, can you see the new root on this one?
Yeah.
That's where all your new roots are always going to be on a rhizome.
There's a bunch of daughters that.
Yes. And in between, in between every single leaf on some irises, in between every single leaf is a daughter. So you think about that. The next year, these daughters are going to bloom. Next year, mother's going to bloom. And then all these daughters will be growing all summer long. And then the next spring, they will bloom. And each one of those will have how many daughters?
Too many.
In this little area.
Yep.
That's why they're so beautiful.
That's why they do that, yeah.
Back to the pots.
Yes.
The ones that are like this, that are big, there's no plastic pots, things to put in them.
It all depends on the type of iris that you want to grow.
Oh.
If you are growing them in containers, some of the irises do want to have very, very good drainage. These bearded irises do not like to sit in water at all. They like to be evenly moist, but they want a drying out period, also between watering. Your other types of irises, some of them can actually be grown in water.
Yeah, but you were talking in terms of the way they were doing pots now. I have containers of flowers, and I know they've made it through one winter.
It could possibly. You never know. Depends
so
on how hard the freeze is.
If you cover them, would it help?
No. What you'd want to do is try to move them into your garage when you're expecting a really hard deep freeze. Yeah. So So where I live is in the Columbia River Gorge on the Washington side. You know where Crown Point is? Mm-hmm. I am the cliffs on the Washington side. I'm on top of those cliffs. So you know, you see on, especially on these guys. So doesn't that make it a little easier to really figure out where you want? You can see that there's, well, I'm going to take out something out of here.
You don't have to save the whole lot, which, you know, pull off what you want.
Right? Look at that. There's nothing in here. This is all old dead. Don't even bother.
Yeah.
Dig up the clump and look to the outside where all of your strong daughters are. And just grab a couple of those on the outside ring. And, another way to do it. It's a lot easier sometimes. Sometimes they won't break out if your soil is not, it really helps if your soil is pliable like this, and or if you just soak the crown in some water overnight. That would really help. Yeah. Yes.
You're wearing gloves.
Yes.
And suppose that is to so you can feel the soil.
So I can see, I can feel the plant. I talked about, you weren't here at the very beginning. These are EMT type gloves. I have the label up here. You can buy these online. I can feel, you can pick up dimes. I can weed, I can feel my fingers. I know what I'm doing. With big leather gloves, you cannot feel what you're doing.
Okay.
This also keeps your fingers from cracking, drying out.
Yes, that's great. But when you're transplanting some plants, you have to be concerned about sterility, whether you are, you have a concern about having your equipment sterile before you start cutting roots and things like that, because you can transpose diseases from one plant to another.
Yes. I'm very, very aware of that when we are, especially when I'm growing plants, and I keep a very watchful eye, and I have shovels that are only for virus plants, and those virus plants are thrown way deep into my woods. They are not touched by anything else. I'm constantly looking for that type of thing going on. And you can just 1% bleach. Most people say go to 10%. You don't need to go to 10%. Just 1% is all you need.
And what type of viruses attack plants?
There's several different kinds of viruses. The one that is really in a lot of irises is called a mosaic virus. And the leaves will have a mosaic type pattern going through them. Whereas they're almost like a cracked stained window, and where the leaves are green and yellow, green, yellow, green, yellow, but they're kind of in like a spider cracked type fashion. I think that's the easiest way. If you've gone down to the Chinese garden, one of the patios, the ice patio, is done in that kind of a pattern. It's like a cracked ice.
And how is this, diseases like that transmitted? Does it come with the plant and
Yes. Once a plant has a virus, it will always have that virus.
So pick it up and
get rid of it.
And does that virus stay in the soil?
No. The viruses are pathogen, are gone from, it's like a blood pathogen.
It has to be on the plant.
It has to be not on the plant, but in the plant. A virus is inside the plant, and how it's transposed is, like you said, by your clippers and or by a sucking insect, you know, like stink bug, or an aphid. Goes from one plant, bites into it, and then transposes it over to another plant. That's the only way. Just like blood-borne pathogens between humans, you can touch a person, you can hug them, you can kiss them, you will not get that virus. Stick a needle in yourself and from that other person, you may get that virus.
And in the cycle of plants, when you find an iris that does have a particular pathogen, is it like tomatoes where you rotate your crops and you do not plant irises back in that soil for a period of time so the stuff just kind of puts itself off?
Not really, because now you're getting into the realm of more onto the bacterial side instead of a virus. And a bacterial is something that would stay in the soil year after year after year. And that's something that you'd want to, transplant out. And that's what I do with mine, especially not so much for a bacterial, but for root nematodes, for little microscopic insects that are in the soil. And that's why I like to go out with another cover crops to change out so the population of the nematodes goes down and gets back to a good balance. All farmers will let you know that if you grow the same crop in the same soil year after year after year, you're not only depleting your soils of the same things that plant wants to take out, but you're also building up the different insects and different pathogens and stuff in that soil that will attack that plant and make it weak.
How do you know if you have a pathogen?
The best way